US are very quick. So typically 2 to 2.5 years you really get a patent in hand in all likelihood. It all again depends on how obvious your thing is. So when we file applications for certain applications where the novelty is very clear, there's absolutely no doubt. So about a year you get a notice of allowance from the USPTO stating that your patent is granted. So it all depends. India, the minimum is 2 to 2.5 years. I think that's the bare minimum. There are some ways by means of which you can expedite the processing of your application, but not something which is usually done. And for a university in particular, there'll be only in one case where you file a PCT application choosing India as the search authority. If you do that part, then you can request for an expedited examination. But otherwise, there's really no other way that you can fasten the process of allowance of an application.
And in those 2.5 years, you cannot have any application of your patents, right? Until it is granted.
You can, on the date of filing of an application, you get an application number, right? So to anywhere you're making a presentation thereafter or anybody whom you're talking to, you can absolutely write patent pending wide application number. So
if you want to have a startup, let's say from your patent,
uh-huh.
So can you start it before it's granted?
Obviously.
After prior?
Yeah. In fact, ideally you can file a patent in the name of the startup also, right? That is what is the DIPP, SIPP scheme all about, where you incorporate a startup at the MCA. You get it accredited to DIPP, and under DIPP, then you start filing all your patents, which is a very cost-effective way of actually even filing it, because you don't have to pay any official, any attorney fee at all. The patent office pays us 10,000 rupees to draft and file an application. You only have to pay the government fees, and startups can always request for expedited examination. They don't have to, the ISR, PCT route that I was talking about, that is not applicable to them. Should I talk more about it? Because I can in 5 minutes if you want, if people need clarity on that. So, DIPP is the Department of Industrial Policy and Promotion. They came up with a scheme in July of 2016 where they said that startups which are recognized by the DIPP and would fall or are a part of the SIPP scheme, which is Startup Incubation Program, something like that. And under the SIPP scheme, there are many facilitators of patents. So, there are, for example, say 5,000 patent agents in India. I don't know the exact number, but let us assume that. So, there was an open call for practitioners who are registered patent agents who want to nominate themselves as facilitators for those startups. So let us say, for example, 2,000 of those patent agents out of 5,000 registered themselves. I am one of those. Now, under the program, if a startup recognized under the SIPP files a patent application, he does not have to pay any attorney fee to the patent attorney at all. He will just have to file that. He will just have to give us the DIPP certificate, the recognition certificate. We will draft the application and then file it at the patent office and only charge the client the government fees of 1,600 rupees, not even 8,000 rupees for the normal entity. So although the application is being filed in the name of the company, the fees applicable is for a startup is for the same fee schedule that is applicable for individuals. So 1600 is the fee for individuals, 8,000 rupees is the fee for normal companies, for example, Indian Oil Corporation. However, if you file an application as a startup, then you only have to pay 1600 bucks. That is to us, because we would have paid that on your behalf at the time of filing of an application. And the patent office then pays us 10,000 rupees to draft and file an application. This does not include the search. And therefore, if you want us to do a patentability search, then we'll have to charge you separately for that. But otherwise, if it's only a matter of drafting and filing, then we can do it in this cost. And therefore, it makes a lot of sense. And this is for the entire period, which means that throughout the application's prosecution, you only have to pay the government fees, which is 1600 rupees and 4000 rupees for examination request. If you want to get an early publication done, then you have to shell out another 2500 rupees. And if you want to file an expedited, then you don't have to abide by any criteria. Your examination request could really be the standard, could be a normal examination request, with expedited being the option that you select there. And in such a case, you could really get a patent in 2 years in India as well. You've got a couple of them since the scheme of things started in about 1.5 to 2 years. Also depends on how fast you are in terms of responding back to the examination report, because you get 6 months. So if you file it really in the end of the 6th month, then you wasted 6 months, right? But if you really do it in a week and the application is absolutely crystal clear, the examination report was largely clear, and it is a matter of a few formalities and the references cited aren't really close enough, then 1.5, 2 years, you can really get a patent. But that is only when you file in the name of the startup. And there are certain criteria under which you can, you are given the startup certificate. Not that everybody can say that I'm a startup. Flipkart come to today and say I'm a startup just because the Economic Times says they are. So there are the certain criteria that they will have to fill in. Any questions on that?
Yeah, sure. This thing, as I'm able to grasp, is that in case of like publications, what we generally do is that we go through review and then our paper, our manuscript gets published. But here it's the other way around. You file a thing, and then there is a like provisional publication, and then you go for the examination or the review, right?
We don't call it provisional, but it's normal publication, basically. Okay. We don't call it provisional, but that's correct. In a way, it is a publication not meant to indicate that you've been granted a patent. It is just a publication so as to indicate to third parties that now you can challenge this patent if you want to before the grant. So it is with that purpose with which the publication happens, not with any other intent.
So, if after the date of the patent publication, can we publish our work in journals?
Absolutely. You can do that even after filing for that matter.
Okay.
So, so you are deemed to be protected from the date of filing. So, fundamentally, if you file a provisional application, the next day you can absolutely publish your paper and sort of take it forward. Just ensure that you file the complaint within 12 months. Okay. Otherwise, your application will be lost out.
Okay.
Anything else? Any other question? Yes, sir.
I very thoroughly listened to your lecture, this paper presentation, but I had a little confusion actually.
Please, sir.
Because the first lecture also I heard it, because there's three things which is applicable for patent is novelty, non-obviousness, and industrial application or some applications for this one. So if we talk about novelty, so we will find out novelty not in India, even throughout the world, across the world or globe when we talk about novelty.
Correct.
But when we file the patent, why not the single agency like WIPO, World Intellectual Property Organization, has been there to at least to carry out this invention across the globe? I'm not talking about regulatory purpose. I'm not talking about in only India and US FDA and all other countries. Because once we are filing in India, maybe after 2 years of the time, maybe my patent is rejected or my application is rejected.
Sure.
So should we have to wait, or should the US people wait till time of the 2 years, or they will file the separate patent over there in the US? So is there any single agency who can examine or scrutinize all the patent, all the idea? Because when we are talking about novelty, we are considering throughout the globe.
So but can you file a, just to answer your question, it is a good concept, and everybody will be talking about a global patent, one examination, one authority, a single application goes through a single processing, and it should be applicable in all countries, and therefore, you know, the application shouldn't be required to file it in different countries. Practically not possible. Fundamentally, because of two or three main reasons. One, if an Indian patent examiner gives you an Indian patent, do you think that the US will agree to the fact that I have enough confidence on the Indian examiners and his capabilities that he would have searched through all the references and the prior arts? Do you think he will have that level of confidence? He won't. And plus, more importantly, although the novelty obviousness laws remain, in terms of the words used, remain consistent across countries, they're applied very differently in different countries. The meaning of inventive step in India is very different from how it is interpreted in the European Union. And thirdly, Indian laws in certain cases, for example, software patenting, Section 3D pertaining to, you know, efficacy of known products and stuff, very different way that Indian examiners would look at such things in view of the Indian patent law compared to how a European examiner. So really streamlining it by centralizing it to one examiner may have a lot of vested interests that might come out, and therefore this activity will be on a country by country basis. We don't see it happening. It's really not possible.
Okay. Because sir, if I am going to roadmap of these highlights of Indian Patent Act, and maybe India, it is taking 1.5 year or 2 years, for example. You know our system better, in Indian system and US system and European system. They are much more faster if we are considering those patent in US and those patent in EU. EU, like you said, that they will not accept the examination of our country, or they will leave or not. This is not. And the same way, if I'm going to patent it, and if Indian system is going to take more and more time, and after it is rejected, and the same patent is accepted by the US. So what do you think in this regard?
What do I think from what perspective?
You know,
there's nothing that this. See, first of all,
why is it not a single guideline authority if the idea is novel? Or I'm talking about commercialization. Is this different? Because the price is different in different countries. They have different kind of price system. They have also a patient system is very different. The clinical manifestation is very different. I'm just talking about idea innovation.
Unfortunately, my answer remains the same, that you can't have centralized. Every examiner will be different. Now, when you come up with something, just because you say it is patentable, should I agree with that? Between the two of us, if we talk about a topic after this lecture, outside in the conference hall, on a given topic, we will have 10 disagreements in 10 minutes of discussion. And we are deliberating a scenario where a patent for a molecule which will sort of have $1 billion value, I will leave it to one guy in one remote patent office to determine whether that gets granted in the US or not, or India or not. It's not practically possible at all. See, this responsibility will have to be on a country-by-country basis. There are massed consequences. As far as the speed is concerned, a lot of us talk about why does it take so long a time in India. First of all, the time is drastically coming down. If you look at the number of examination reports which were issued in 2015, number of patents granted in 15, the rate of filing hasn't gone steeply high. Rate of filing, but the rate of granting, I won't say even granting, disposal, because it could be refusal as well. If you look at the 2015-17 numbers, it's a drastic difference. We used to get one or two examination reports in 2015, now we get 10 a day. So you can imagine, and the volume is largely remaining the same as far as the filing trend is concerned, hasn't really changed that much. And therefore, I can absolutely, with a lot of confidence, tell you that Indian Patent Office is processing applications, and in the next 2 years you'll talk about, you'll hear about it very, very thoroughly and objectively. Another thing, I don't think European Patent Office is fast enough. Sometimes they take years to get you a patent granted, and we've seen instances where even the Indian application got processed before the European application did. US is faster, it's established everybody knows about it, everybody talks about it. And one more thing, before I stop on that topic, how does it matter if it takes 5 years or 3 years? Answer that question. Does it limit your capability of licensing your patent? Does it reduce the... people say that if it takes 5 years, my invention will not have industrial application after 5 years. How does it matter? You file the application today, you start licensing it tomorrow. Nobody says that you can license or sell or monetize or commercialize your patent only after grant of the patent. Who says that? No. The only demerit is that you cannot litigate. You cannot enforce your patent if somebody else copies it. But in how many scenarios does it any which way happen? That people have copied it and you cannot go to the court because of this reason? Rarely. I would say rare, but the percentage is very less. So I don't think you should worry too much about the fact that the granting will give you a higher value and the pendency will hurt you for 5 years and I cannot do anything. I don't think that's the case at all. We work with TIFR, which is Tata Institute of Fundamental Research. They have a very clear policy. They'll file a provisional application. They'll give the inventor and the attorney 12 months to file a licensee. If they get a provisional or a potential licensee on the plate within 12 months, they'll be funded for complete and PCT. Otherwise, they'll not be funded. So it does not matter at all if your patent application is at what stage of processing. It is just a myth that people carry that after grant, I will have a better likelihood of allowance. I don't think it matters at all. When you go to a company, they'll read your claims, they'll look at the construction of the claims, how broad they are, how narrow they are, and how they are appearing, what kind of scope would it cover, and that's about that good enough for them to have confidence in you. It helps, but not that significant.
I have one very extension of what you've been explaining. So who are actually the examiners? I mean, do the inventor have the right to
No, unfortunately not, ma'am. Everybody has relatives in India.
So, like for publication, we always suggest reviewers' name because we know who are the top-notch in that particular field.
Correct.
Who are the better people who can assess your work.
Unfortunately not, ma'am. It is all a very random process. In fact, it happens, as I said, that you file an application in Delhi Patent Office, but the controller who's allocated to you is actually from Chennai. So it is a very random process. Used to be more straightforward when there were lesser examiners and controllers, but now that there are too many of them, it is randomly allocated. I don't think even the examiners have really a control. It is purely random, but I'm not sure.
So is it like some attorney offices, they already have some defined people in a particular area? How does it work?
It works like that only. There's a patent office in Dwarka and four other, in other metros of the country, and there are about 300, 500, 600 examiners keep going up and down. Examiners are the ones who do the search and generate the examination reports. Controllers are the ones who take a call finally on whether the application is allowed or not. So the hearing is always done by the controller, but the examination, the real searching of novelty and the inventive step is all done by the examiners, who are relatively junior to the controllers. Examiners eventually graduate to become controllers after substantial experience. So the examiners are randomly allocated. They have technical background, mechanical, semiconductors, electronics, electrical, pharmaceutical, and they're...
So just for the benefit of the students, because many students also want to take it as a career perspective. So what kind of education experience is required to get into those kind of jobs?
Who wants to become an examiner here? You want to become an examiner, really? No, no, that will make you a patent agent. No, you said the examiner. Never heard. This is the first time that I'm hearing somebody who has a career choice of wanting to become an examiner.
Because people, see, I don't think really people have an idea. IPR, everybody is attracted by the word IPR. But what all goes into it as far as, of course, attorney-wise, patent attorneys, that is there. But to the level, because I heard even from US, people have approached, people who have done PhDs and
science. To become examiners.
To evaluators, or I don't know, maybe I'm putting the right
word. No, but you can put it the right word. So the fundamentals are very simple, that you have these examiners who have to undergo, the examination, which is largely technical, and the patent law is also coming into the picture. Once they're inducted into the patent office, they go to Nagpur, which has the training institute, NIIPM, and then they get undergo a training of 6 months or 6 weeks, I don't know. But after the training, they're deputed and posted across multiple offices, across the four offices. And there's a very, very short time span. You know, the postings happen very quickly these days. So every year, every 6-8 months, they'll be posted from Calcutta to Delhi. And if sometimes the examination is happening in Delhi, and the same examiner then moved out, and therefore we then have to correspond with him in the other office. But the process is simple. If you want to apply, the examination that happens, there are two parts to it, the Patent Act clarity and the technical clarity on that particular subject matter.
So what is the growth perspective
like? Ma'am, I will be beaten by the patent office if I talk about it. How about the growth perspective, literally? I don't know if there's somebody here, but I don't want to comment about it. But I would rather, honestly speaking, I would rather become a patent attorney than an examiner. I mean, that's my personal choice. I hope you're not from the office.
The salaries are very good.
I won't say the salary is motivated that much, because the exposure that you get there, actually, because you're examining a good number of applicants, just that I think culturally the law firms will train you better. That's how I would put it across. That is, the mentoring is better, the stress levels are higher, but you know how much you're able to learn in 6, 8, 10, 12 months, 24 months will be much faster in a law firm compared to at the patent office, because the government is government at the end of the day, and that is how it works. Please.
If we have to file our patent in the different countries, including the India, is it advantageous to be filing through PCT, including the India, or we can file a different application in India and for the other countries through PCT?
So in typical scenario, this is the process for the PCT. So let me cover this and then I'll answer your question. This is the exact slide. We file the Indian application, called as the priority date. You file the PCT, for which you get the 12 months of time from the everything is from the priority date. Now the application again published 18 months from priority date. Both the applications get published, the Indian one as well as the PCT counterpart, and then you get 30 months. So the Indian application is independently in parallel being processed, and in 30 months from the priority date, you've got to choose the countries that you want to go in. So US, China, Japan, Korea, whichever countries that you want to go in. Now, your question of can we file two independent applications which are not related, I think the timing will play a big role. If you're filing the same application at two different countries, or one at India and one at the PCT, I don't see what logic would it make. I won't sort of see. What a lot of people do is to sort of, pharma companies in particular, what they do is that they file a provisional in India. They file a PCT based that provisional, so they don't file the complete at all. They don't file, it is not mandatory for you to file a complete of a provisional if you're filing a PCT. So you file a provisional, 12 months you file a PCT application, and then in 30 months you come back into India. And then the life of your patent application starts from the PCT application date. Because that's the rule as far as the Indian. So 20 years start from the date of filing of the international application, which is the PCT. So although your protection is from the date of provisional, but your 20 years start from this, you really are able to save a year. Actually, 1 year for pharma companies to be able to exclusively sell a particular molecule is a big, big, big thing. And therefore, that is one way you can extend the life of your own application, but again, not very usually or typically adopted. But I would never want to file two different applications. So usually you would want to file in Indian, file the PCT, or if you do not want to file the PCT because your country of interest, for example, we represent Tejas Networks, which is one client that we sort of file only US applications for. They're not interested in Europe, China, Japan, any other country. And in which scenario, we file the Indian, and then within 12 months, we'll directly go through the Paris Convention route to file the US application. The US one is in parallel being examined, and the US one gets allowed in 2 to 2.5 years. Indian one takes 3.5 to 4 years. So that is how it is. Any question on the procedure part? It was largely done with the procedural part of it. Now there are certain types of searches. Yes, ma'am. Absolutely.
In that case,
which is the reason I was mentioning to your colleague that, you know, the harmonization of examination is really not practical. Absolutely, which is why I said Section 3D software patenting is very different. You know how it is examined in the European Union, the standards for test of abstractness, the 101, 112 requirements in the US are way different from how they are in India. The way you respond back to applications. And before I come to this, what time is it?
So you should have it.
So can you give me the time?
It's 12:50.
5:50. Okay, I wanted to give clarity on one thing that I think a lot of people do not really invest too much of time and energy, particularly the inventors. Now, this is called as a test of infringement. And we talk about it even at an attorney level, but there's slight bit of lack of clarity that we see. Now, I am a very firm believer there are two kinds of patents which are granted. One is a patent, one is a good patent. Now, a good patent will be a patent which is broad and gives you enough leverage for you to be able to enforce your rights onto companies which are infringing on your patent. Now, the test is very clear. Of if somebody asks me that, Tarun, how do you evaluate whether a product when commercialized is infringing on a patent or not? Now, if you would listen to this carefully, I think this will give some clarity. A product infringes on a patent in most cases. You know, there are there's one literal infringement, there's non-literal infringement, but for the simplicity of the discussion, I will only limit myself to literal infringements. So a product infringes on a patent only when it comprises of all the elements. The product should have all the elements of any one independent claim of the patent which is granted. Am I clear? Now, under this context, what is a good patent? The one that has more elements in the first independent claim or the one that has lesser number of elements? Anybody says more? Anybody says more? Why lesser the better? Please, sir.
Should be more, because then any product, if he wants to use that patent, then he will have to purchase that patent.
Agreed. But what was the test that I told you about? The test, I'll repeat it again, and then you tell me if your answer still remains the same. The test is that a product infringes on a patent only when the product comprises or has all the elements of at least one independent claim. Let us assume that there is only one independent claim in that particular application, and that claim has five elements. A product will infringe on that particular patent only when it has all the five elements of that. Now, is it better to have, is the patent better when it has five elements or eight elements? Five or eight?
Five.
Anybody says eight?
No, eight, because then the other one can't copy all the eight.
It's correct. Right. Would he infringe in such a scenario?
No, you would.
Correct. So do you?
Yeah, so you should have.
No, so the question is, do you want people to infringe on your patent or
no,
not?
I don't want.
Then why are you filing it now?
No, but
you want people to
infringe.
Correct, but you safeguarding to an extent where somebody comes up, you've got eight elements. Let us
have. You can copy only a few.
Only a few and make largely the same product as yours and start selling it. And you'll not be able to touch him by virtue of the fact that you had eight elements in your first claim. Had you got,
some of them would be.
Correct, that is exist. But that is the test that I talked about, right? I said all elements rule. This is called as all. So a product infringes on a patent, then it has all the elements. That is the reason why I said all, because the core emphasis on all. This is called as the all elements rule. So all means that if you've got five elements in your first claim, and if this guy takes four out of them, but does not use the fifth one, then he's not infringed. This is literal infringement. India is deviating away from it. So I'm you know, this is you know, one caveat that I'm just mentioning it here, that India doesn't follow literal nowadays in totality, but literal is the, this is the definition for literal.
That it should be that even if one is infringed, he is not infringed.
Unfortunately not, ma'am, because one patent is given for one invention. So do you want to say that if he's got which, so is that possible? The patent act is very clear. One patent for one invention, two patents for two inventions. And therefore, you will, a product will infringe on a patent only when it has all the five elements. So do we largely agree that lesser the elements, broader the patent, better the patent?